don't have that much time. So I'm a weatherman, but there's no weather, so I do this too. Today we have scattered clouds. There's one over L.A., one over Phoenix. The job with the fewest perks in the news business, the weatherman. Sports guy, Kareem's house for barbecues on the weekend. Entertainment guy gets to go to Stallone's house for meetings. The weatherman gets to go outside. If you ever want to go out there, I know everyone out there, I'll get you right out, no waiting. There's no bad weather here because God doesn't think California people can deal with it emotionally. I happen to come from a state where there's real weather, Pennsylvania. Any transplanted Pennsylvania people here? All right. But you had to have some snow at Christmas. It's part of the deal. You'd be 8 or 9 years old, and you go out and play in 5 or 6 feet of snow all day and never come in until it was absolutely necessary. Mom, open the door. I can't feel my arms and legs anymore. Mom! Out here, we're wimps. Oh, God. You know, the ceiling fan was on high in that French restaurant last night. If I don't get pneumonia, it'll be a miracle. People wear down-filled parkas into the frozen food section of the supermarket in this city. This was a great job about a year and a half ago when they had the Chernobyl incident with the radiation cloud from Russia. And a clear-thinking NBC News executive said, well, it is a cloud. It must fall under Fritz's jurisdiction. Pull it. Fritz did the radiation report. But trying to deliver this information tastefully was the problem. Look at that radiation map. The glowing green arrows where we expect the cloud to be this time tomorrow. Forecast partly iridescent. And we'll have a 60% chance of a future, as a matter of fact. But I'm glad to have a job because I'm no Dan Quayle. Vice President Dan Quayle. A leader? Maybe captain of a beach volleyball team. And I'm not mad at him. He got the gig because somebody offered it to him. I'm mad at his friends for not telling him. Dan, you're biting off a little more than you can chew here. Settle down. How about that management training program at Sears? I think you're making a real serious... mad at friends. I feel the same way about a woman in excess of 300 pounds who would wear spandex in public. Not that there's anything wrong with being overweight. I'm terribly underweight. I'm thin. I'm too white for public consumption. It's called anorexia caucasia. I'm not proud of that. But a woman that would wear 300 pounds and wear spandex in public needs to be told by her friends, dear, this is not your venue. Stretchable fabric is not your milieu, if you mind. When you can actually hear the clothing go, oh, yeah. And it's not her fault. It's her friend's fault. Well, I'm a father, and I have a new child on the way. I just found that out. I have a new baby coming April 26th. Thank you. More snow? Is that what you said? Or what a stud? He said either more snow or what a stud. I wasn't... But you're right in both accounts, sir. But the scariest thing I ever had to do was about a month ago. I had to put my wife and my two-year-old on an airplane for his first airplane ride. To relinquish everything you love to the airline industry in its present condition is not fun. I hate to fly. I'm terrified by it. It's a phony experience. The people that work in the airplane are putting on this facade of being comfortable when, in fact, they, too, are terrified. The food is fake on an airplane. You get a little steak. Nowhere else on the planet do you get a piece of meat that looks like that. Is there a ranch in Dallas where they raise airline cattle? Little things that look like a dachshund with an udder hanging down? With a bell around their neck going, moo, and they butcher them up and make airline steaks out of them. Why do they insist on feeding you on an airplane? You have no room to eat. You have no elbow room. The tray hits you right here. And at 35,000 feet, you eat like a praying mantis. Huh. And hit an air pocket and lance the groin of the man sitting next to you. Then after you eat on an airplane, you're forced to do the second most horrifying thing. Use the bathroom on an airplane. For a man, an absolute waste of time. You're standing back there. Every muscle in your body is tense, counterbalancing the movement of the aircraft. It's impossible to relax enough to allow the normal... Plus, your head's at a 45-degree angle. Because the cockpit of the airplane, and it's physiologically impossible to do what you have to do with your head at a 45-degree angle. There's a bubble in your pituitary gland. Your head has to be perpendicular to the horizon. Otherwise, you can stand 8-9 hours in there. And... Plus, I need the security and comfort of relatively clean white porcelain in the bathroom area. I don't want a sucking stainless steel hole in the side of the fuselage. Articles of clothing are being ripped off your back. Just part of the cooling system of the aircraft. What is that? To answer your question, morning clouds and fog, hazy afternoon sun. Tomorrow we'll be having a Santa Ana condition here in Los Angeles. That's a warm, dry wind caused by all the gardeners in Beverly Hills with those leaf blowers on their backs, blowing them simultaneously in a westerly direction. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.